That's how the Maker makes out the case for the understanding of the Vedas, and so the vichara, dharma vichara, otherwise why should we understand anything? So dharma vichara is understanding. Anyway, so that's what is meant, svadhyaya vinehe arthavabodha paryantatvena, that when the Veda says that you must study the Veda, svadhyaya adhyetavya, or whenever your father says go to school, arthavabodha paryantatvena, that you must study, pursue the study of the Vedas until you understand the meaning. Jyotishtomadi vidhyartha jnane vidhyantram na apekshate. And therefore, when you come across the statements, Jyotishtomena yajeta svarga kamaha, that one desires of the svarga must perform the yaga called Jyotishtoma, that you will come across the statement and then you will understand the statement also, because you will not merely repeat the statement, but then you are required to understand the meaning of the statement. And so you will know the statement. So, Jyotishtomena yajeta svarga kamaha, the statement will also be understood by the one who studies the Vedas, because that is called study, when you understand what you are repeating. So therefore, no separate inducement is required to ask you to understand what you are studying. Because when it is said that you must study, it is understood that you must understand what you are listening to. Now don't repeat the passages of Sanskrit, you know, as the children used to do. Sanskrit passages are repeat, and the translation also is memorized. So all you need to do is to remove, just see the first sentence of the passage, last sentence of the passage. You need not read what is in between, because you don't understand what it is anyway. But you know what the passage means, so repeat the whole thing. All the examiners have to do is to remove one sentence from in between, that's all. And then they know that this fellow has mugged up everything. Anyway, my uncle used to tell me, when they were studying, there used to be English medium in the high school. And they used to study history and geography and all of this in English, you know. So there was one friend of his, when they were studying in high school, he used to simply mug up, memorize the whole history and everything, you know. So my uncle would ask me, but fellow, do you understand what you're memorizing? So I need not understand, the examiner will understand, you know. So that is how they just memorize. And this is how we think that we have learned. So there was a, right from the beginning, there's an emphasis that you must understand whatever you are listening to or what you are repeating. So therefore, no further inducement is required for you to be told that you must understand the statement Jyotishtomena yajeta. To understand that statement, the Vidhi is already there earlier. When your father sent you to school, it was understood that you must understand all these things. And therefore the father need not say that, may you understand geography and history and every sentence of that, because all that is included in the first instruction. So just as you do not require a separate inducement to understand the statement of the Karmakanda, similarly of Vidhyantaram na apekshate tatha jnana kande vishyat, similarly also we say that no further vidhi or inducement is required to make you understand the meaning of the statements of the Upanishads, because that is already included in the first vidhi, that you are Upanishads are also part of the Vedas. So therefore, when you repeat the Upanishads, then you must also understand what the Upanishads mean. Maybe that understanding will be of a different dimension, and you may have to go to the teacher to understand, but that understanding also is included in the very first vidhi. And so, no further vidhi is required to induce you to understand the statements of the Upanishad. So it is said, nacha vakyartha jnane vijnane vidhi prayuktaha pravartate. It is not that you require somebody to induce somebody in order to know the meaning of the statement of the Upanishad. That when someone listens to the Upanishad, then naturally that person will pursue that listening until the person understands the meaning. And so, and when the meaning is understood, all the akanshas are released. And when no akanshas are there, there is no, you cannot say that these statements create akanshas. They in fact remove the akanshas. Then says Anandagiri, tatrapi vedaha krishnaha adhigantavyaheti vidhyantara prayuktameva vakyasa jnana vidyashankyaha. Tatrapi, even in Karmakanda also, Vedaha krishnaha adhigantavyaha. This is, Krishna means sartaha. that you must know the Vedas along with the meaning, that's the vidhi. Idi vidhyantra prayuktame vakyartha jnanam. That no, not only svadhyaya adhyetavya, but another vidhi, Vedah krishna adhigantavya, that one must study the Vedas along with the meaning. And because of that other vidhi, that one actually is induced to even study the karmakanda and know what it says. So in short, even for, he is trying to say that for understanding the statement of karmakanda also, you require other vidhi, other than that svadhyaya adhyetavya. Bhashyakara says, you just go on and on like this, says vidhyantara, Bhashya says, vidhyantara prayuktau cha anavastha dosham avochama. Alright, say that you are induced to understand the meaning of the karmakanda vakyas because of this vidhi, Vedaha krishna adhigantavya, let us say that. It is that vidhi which has induced you to understand the meaning of the karmakanda vakyas. The next question is, but then this Vedaha krishna adhigantavya also is a Veda vakya. And who will induce you to understand that vakya? You require some other vidhi. If this fellow requires inducement to understand anything, then he will require inducement to understand what you are telling him, you see. After all, if you induce him, go and study that. But he should understand at least that much. He should understand the meaning of that statement, go and study. For that also he requires another inducement. Then his mother has to say, hey, go and listen to your father. Then he goes and listens to his father. But then why should he listen to his mother? Then his brother has to say, you must listen to your mother. But why should he listen to his brother? Then his sister has to say, and like that, who will he listen to? For first listening, at least somewhere the initiative has to come. And it comes. People listen to all kinds of junk. So when they can listen to all kinds of useless things in life, why should they require inducement to listen to this? And that is how we already said, that if you think that you require vidhi to know something, that vidhi vakya itself must be understood in order for you to be induced there, then who will prompt you to understand vidhi vakya, some other vidhi vakya, and like this, it is an endless process. Anavastha dosham avochama. Already we have said that this leads to an infinite regression. Then says Anvigiri, Shrutahani, Ashrutakalpuna Prasangacha, Na Vidisheshatvam Vedantanam. Shrutahani. Shrutahani means the loss of what is told. Ashrutakalpuna, a projection or imagination of what is not mentioned. So when we specifically mention something, that fellow says, well, that's okay, you said it. But then still, I understood it this way. So sometimes what we do is, even when something is very clearly told us, we don't accept it or we reject it or we dismiss that. And instead, we imagine something else. That is called Shrutahani, Ashrutakalpana. I told you to go to that shop and get it. You told me, but anyway, I thought that you meant something else, you know. So sometimes that's what we say. Yeah, you told me to go there, but I thought that you meant that I should go to some other place. Which means that you are, first of all, dismissing what I said and imagining what I did not say. So you are putting words in my mouth and things like that. I mean, the idea is that very often people just disregard what is clearly told. So now, this is how it is, you know. So I know that you say this. But even if you say this, then also I know that you do not mean it, and therefore you mean this, and that is how Shrutahani, Ashrutakalpana. Every day this business is there. Everywhere. But I said this. I know you said it. But I know you did not mean that. Now? So you imagine what I meant. That means that you imagine that I meant something other than what I said. So people stress this whole vyavahara up to Vedas also. Shrutahani, Ashrutakalpana. That means that rejecting or dismissing what has been said openly, and imagining or projecting what has not been said. And it's all communication. Understand that they are teaching us the art of communication. And what kind of lapses are there in communication? And 90% of the problems of the world are only because of this faulty communication. That what the person understands is different from what the fellow says, and what he says is different from what he thinks, and what he thinks is different from what the truth is, you know. And that is how it just goes on and on. And therefore, most of the problem, that is why you study this, at least you learn the art of communication. Art of properly communicating our own ideas, and the art of understanding somebody else's ideas. And when that is done, then as you say, 90% of the problems will be removed. That's all the problems are here. That's what the Vaishyakara has to deal with those fellows, you know. Because Vedada Pramanam, they also look upon Vedada's Pramanam as staunchly as we look upon. So, if we are not talking here with the people who are Nastikas, who don't believe in the Vedas, then we'll deal with them differently. The people who are in our own school, as staunch and more staunch than we are, except taking Vedas Pramanam, so they are with us, in fact, in fighting with other fellows who are Nastikas. But then we have to deal with them also, because they go to some other extremes, you know. Because they want to impose upon the Vedas ideas that they have. Generally speaking, this is what we tend to do. We generally read not what is written, but what we want to read. And we hear not what is said, but what we want to hear. This is a common thing. And that being the case, even when I am reading, there is reading in between lines and hearing in between words and things like that. And so, that is why we hear what we want to hear. We understand what we want to understand. Because we have a conclusion of what he wants to say. Or we have a conclusion of what he should say. And therefore, that conclusion being there, whatever I listen subsequently is going to be influenced by that conclusion that I already have. So when the mind is not open, that is why we say that when we listen, listening is a very important phenomenon. It is an art. Listening is an art because it requires an open mind. It requires a fresh mind. Every moment it should be open. If ideal listening is that, where even a moment, suppose I had some kind of a transaction with this person just 10 minutes ago, and then I go to the class and listen, or whatever. Or I know this person in a different way, and I come across this person now. Every moment must be met as a fresh moment, if you can do that. If you can bracket or set aside all previous conclusions and notions, and just apply ourselves at the moment fresh, that is called the open mind. An open mind is that mind where all the previous notions and conclusions of emotional nature, all of them are set aside. And I deal with a person or a situation or what I listen to as something that is fresh. In life also it will be so useful. Whenever I meet a person, I do not meet the person as the person is. I always look upon the person with a whole load of the conclusions and the prejudices I have about that person. And therefore, I tend to interpret the behavior of that person based on what conclusions obtained. And very often we fail to even appreciate simple things. Somebody may have said, "How are you?" and I say, "See, he didn't say that." Or somebody may not have said, and I may say, you know, things like that. Our mind becomes so closed very often that we just impose or listen what our mind thinks it is, rather than in reality what it is. Now of course that is a problem for life. That's a problem of the transaction with the people day to day, moment to moment. Since the mind is always loaded with prejudices or likes and dislikes and previous conclusions, we rarely meet any situation fresh. There is always a staleness in our mind which it is imposed upon the situation. And of course even the Shravanam, listening to the scriptures also is going to take place in that way, because already I have conclusions about the self, conclusions about God, conclusions about Vedas, conclusions about everything. With all the conclusions I hear, and with a mind that is concluded I hear, it is natural to have conclusions. There is nobody who will not have conclusions, because it is the nature of the intellect to conclude. It's called adhyavasayatmika buddhi. Buddhi is that whose nature it is to draw conclusions. So we are going to have conclusions. They say, don't be judgmental. That's what they say. Don't be judgmental, meaning don't judge. That's what it means. That do not judge any given situation. Do not prejudge anything. Meet every situation fresh. Meaning, that let your past prejudices and past conclusions not influence the present one. It is not possible, this is an ideal situation. It is not possible at all. But to the extent that we can meet this ideal situation of meeting every moment afresh, and particularly listening to scriptures, that we can have a mind wherein all my present conclusions are set aside. They call it bracketed. Don't reject anything. We don't say that you reject your conclusions. We don't say that you swallow what is being said. We just say that give it a benefit of doubt. Meaning, listen to it with an open mind, that what I am listening to may be right. Maybe what the fellow says is what he means. How do you know? ये तो कहवा टेव पड़ेगा ये तो कह है तो चाले आज कह तो होय आज यू એટલે કે આપણે માની લેવાનો યુ નો જસ્ટ બીકોઝ હી સેઝ ડઝન્ટ મીન ધેટ હી મીન્સ ધેટ નો ધેટ મીન્સ ઓલરેડી વી હેવ બ્રાન્ડેડ ધેટ પર્સન હાઉ ડુ યુ નો મે બી વોટ ધ પર્સન સેઝ વોટ ધ પર્સન મીન્સ ધીસ ઇઝ કોલ્ડ શબ્દ પ્રમાણમ ધેટ્સ વોટ શંકરાચાર્ય સે દે સે નૈયાયિકા ધેટ નો નો પ્રમાણમ ઇઝ ઓન્લી વેરિફિકેશન The Svatah Pramanyam is not there. Paratah Pramanyam, meaning when you see something or when you hear something, that can be taken to be right only when you verify it. So you see a piece of silver and you think it is silver. Says, no, that could very well be a Brahma or a delusion, because when you go there and you pick up, you find that it is a shell. Therefore, you can't believe what you see. You can only believe something that you experience or when it is verified. That when that object serves the purpose of silver, then alone you know that your knowledge of silver is right. But the point is, where will this process end? You go and find out that it is shell, but how will you believe that it is shell? Again, at some point in time, you would accept your perception by the eyes. Similarly also, even when a person says something which you disbelieve, let us say, and you're waiting for a verification of the truth of what the person has said, even the verification is done by the same mind that is listening now, and therefore, how do you know that your verification also is not prejudiced? You should understand what I'm saying. Ultimately, it is that mind alone which is... So at some point in time, you have to call it yes. Somewhere the process has to come to an end and you come to a conclusion. The fact that all the conclusions were drawn in our life is because somewhere we said that this is what it is. So sometime you have to say this is what it is. And who says that? Your own mind says that. Then why can't you say it right away? When somebody says something, why can't they accept it right then rather than waiting for verification? Because then also it is verification by the same mind. Swamiji, avu na chale loko kshetri jese tamne. That's all right. Suppose they do that. Then also what? As I said, where will you ever have trust? Then we cannot trust anything. When we cannot trust anything, how shall I trust my own conclusion also? And so, maybe our experience is such that all our trust has been perhaps misplaced, or all our trust has been, we have been deceived and stuff like that. So we have become people who cannot trust anything. And it's true, you cannot trust anything. But anyway, you have to trust that judgment that you cannot trust anything. Somewhere the trust has to be. And therefore, you begin with the trust. At the most you will be disappointed. All right, so what? But then if you don't trust, then also you could have lost the opportunity of trusting and getting the benefit of trust. So it's an even deal, isn't it? That I don't trust a person. Maybe the person is trustworthy and I did not trust. And therefore, I lost the benefit. And I trusted, maybe the person is not trustworthy and I trusted, then I got the disadvantage or whatever it is. We never know, because it's always a matter of conjecture, it's always a matter of inference or imagination in my mind whether I should trust or not. Anyway, at least when we come to scriptures, hopefully that process has to come to an end. And therefore, somewhere you have to have an inducement from within, that's all. That there is an inducement from within. You don't always need inducement from outside. So there is an inducement for listening to Vedas and for understanding what the Vedas say, and you don't require inducement for the inducement. because that will require yet another inducement. So anyway, all this discussion started because of Srutahani Ashruta Kalpana. Srutahani is that I dismiss what I hear. Ashruta Kalpana is I project what I don't hear. And when a person does not trust, the same thing will be extended up to Vedas also. Says footnote number 8 on that page. Shrutasya avidisheshattva rupa svatantrasya hani ashruta videhe kalpana. Shrutasya avidisheshattva rupasya rupa svatantrasya hani. So what you hear, shrutam means what? Shrutya pratipadidam. What the Shruti says in its own words. Avidisheshattva rupa svatantrasya. That the Upanishad says in very clearly that Atma in fact cannot become a part of any kind of a vidhi, cannot become any part of karma. That's how Vashyakara begins the introduction to Ishavasya Upanishad, that Atma cannot become an accessory to karma because there is no kartrutva. Atma cannot become material which you can offer. Atma cannot become the very offerer also because there is no kartrutva. So karma sheshatvam is not there in Atma, Atma is akarma shesha. And thus when we very clearly hear that Atma is not shesha, it is svatantra. That which serves the purpose of something else is called is paratantra. And that which serves the purpose of itself is called svatantra. And therefore Atma stands on its own. And this statement of the Upanishads also have pramanyam, swarthe pramanyam, meaning that they convey their own meaning without, that they don't serve the purpose of something else. So this svatantram is there that you are not accepting. Ashruta videhe kalpana. There is no vidivakya in Upanishad. Still you are imagining vidivakya by branding the Upanishad statement as arsavada or something or the other. And therefore, sometimes vidhi is not directly there, but if the statement is arsavada, you can see a vidhi there. So you are seeing something which is not clearly said, and you are ignoring something that is very clearly said. Iti prasangaccha. Na vidisheshatvam vedantanam. Therefore we say that Vedantas cannot be vidishesha, meaning cannot serve the purpose of a vidhi. So nacha, that we say it all, says Bhashya, nacha ekamevad vidiyam brahma, ekamevad vidiyam brahma ityadi vakyeshu vidhi avagamyade atma swarupa anvakshane naiva avasitatva ekamevadvidiyam. There is no brahma there, it's just ekamevadvidiyam. So whatever, so ekamevadvidiyam, brahma is in the parenthesis, that brahman is one without a second. Ityadi vakyeshu, in vakya such as this, na vidhi avagamyate. We do not, na avagamyate means na shruyate. Where is the vidhi here? It's just a statement of fact that Brahman is one without a second, that Atma is nitya shuddha buddha. These are just statements of facts. We do not find vidhi or an injunction or instruction there. Why do we say there is no vidhi there? Atma swarupa anvakhyane naiva avasitatvat sapalatvat. Atmasvarupa anvakhyanam, atmasvarupa kathanam. It is merely by delineating the nature of the self, that's what they do, and that is where, that is the purpose that they serve. So they have fulfilled their purpose by delineating or expounding the nature of Atma, that's all. Atmasvarupa anvakhyanenaiva avasitatvat. And so the statements do not want to do anything else other than merely revealing the nature of the self. And so there is no vidhi, you cannot see any vidhi there. And so to imagine that there is within the Upanishadic statements is not right. Then Anandagiri continues, Vedantaha Svarthenamanam. See the footnote number 9. Vedantaha Ivi Vedanteshu Vidinirasena Atmasvarupa matra avasayitvam uttam etavata. So, Edavada, by the Grantha, by the section that has preceded, Vedanteshu Vidhinirasena Atmasvarupa Matrava Sahitvam, the earlier statement said, Atmasvarupa Anvakhyaneneva Avasitatvat, that the Veda Upanishadic statements merely delineate the nature of the Atma, explain the nature of Atma or the reality, and that's all the purpose that they serve, and they find their fulfillment in just doing that. This is what has been said. So now, a new question arises. That's what they do, that's all they do. So says Anandagiri, Vedantaha Swarthe Namanam. All this discussion came in the Brahma Sutra Bhashya, which is the fourth sutra. So it is all, again, it comes up here to refresh all our memory of what was discussed at that time. Vedantaha Swarthena Manam. Vedantaha means Upanishad. The Upanishads are not Pramanam Swarthe, meaning that they do not have Pramanyam in themselves, but that Upanishads are Pramanam only by serving the purpose of Karmakanda. This is the standard position of the Mimamsakas, that Upanishads do not have the status, independent status of a scripture by themselves, but independent, the Upanishads only can be called scripture in as much as they serve the purpose of Karmakanda. Karmakanda is the main scripture, Upanishad is a supporting scripture. What we say is, Upanishad is the main scripture, Karmakanda is, we say at the moment Karmakanda is its own scripture, Upanishad other scripture, because both of them address different vishayas. Science is its own scripture, and Vedanta is its own scripture. You don't have to compare them. Science addresses itself to the matter, and Vedanta addresses itself to spirit. So even the whole realm of inquiry, investigation being different, you don't have to find parallels. And poor Vedantins do not have to justify themselves by saying that we are scientific and stuff like that. There is such an inferiority complex here, you know, that we feel that we are not good unless we feel that we meet the criteria, you know, of science. So you, otherwise they will say you are superstitious and they will dismiss you. And so we have to prove ourselves that we are scientific. Except that science depends upon the perceptual investigation and requires an evidence. And perceptual evidence is what is required, and that kind of a criterion cannot be met with here. As perception understood by science, yat sakshat aparokshat brahma, that is also perceptual knowledge which is called aparoksha jnanam. But that the scientists will always call mystical, they will call superstition, they will call psychological problem and stuff like that, because it cannot be verified in laboratory and therefore. The knowledge that we are talking about, that knowledge is not by the same means as the knowledge that a scientist gains. And that being the case, it is very difficult to compare them. So even though there are modern books which compare the discoveries of physics with Upanishad, that comparison also cannot go too far, because what the Upanishads are talking about is Atma, and what the physics is dwelling upon is Mithya. And that being the case, to find comparison also would be very difficult, you know, because physics addresses itself to understanding matter, which is Mithya. So there is a tremendous confusion there. And when you try to describe Atma in the words, then also similar kind of problems arise, and so it looks as though both of them are talking about the same entity. We do not say that both of them talk about the same entity. Anyway, still coming back to Karmakanda, we say that Karmakanda is a scripture in itself, its vishaya is karma, and Upanishads are scriptures in themselves, its vishaya in Brahma. So Karmakanda is pramanyam, or the authority or validity with reference to dharma, and Upanishads are validated with reference to Brahma. Then we will say, once they accept it that dharma is mithya and Brahma alone is satyam, therefore Upanishad alone is ultimately valid, so we might come around that way. But at the moment we say that Karmakanda, which talks about dharma, is pramanam with reference to dharma, Upanishad is pramanam with reference to Brahma. They say Brahma, there is no, even if such an entity called Brahma is of no use. They say that something is useful when it serves a purpose in life. What's the use of this academic knowledge that you are Brahman, so what? you must do something. Which knowledge serves a purpose in life? That knowledge which enables you to accomplish something. The knowledge that enables you to achieve something that you don't have. The knowledge that enables you to fulfill your aspirations and ambitions. That is the knowledge. And aspirations and ambitions cannot be fulfilled unless you do something. Merely by knowing that, you know, this is Mount Everest or this is whatever it is, or this is Badrinath. That doesn't serve the purpose. You must do something to reach there. And so, karma is a means, jnanam serves the purpose. This is their conclusion. So naturally, they study the Upanishad also with this conclusion. In what manner does the Upanishad serve the purpose of performing some ritual or something so that I can accomplish something that I have not accomplished? Whereas Vedanti has to say that there is nothing to be accomplished in life. How can you say that? I am a miserable person, you know. How do you think that I am going to remain miserable without doing something? He says, you are not miserable. You think that you are miserable. So that very conclusion is questioned by the Vedanta. That I am a miserable person, that I am a liberated person, that I am a small insignificant entity, he says, you have just taken yourself for granted without really inquiring into what the true nature of that I is. So very fundamental differences are there. One person takes for granted that sense of limitation and wants to remove it by doing something about it. Other person questions that very sense of limitation. So before you proceed to do something, first of all determine whether or not what you have concluded about yourself is right or not. So that self-conclusion itself is questioned here. And therefore the statements delineating the self are valid because your conclusion is not valid. And when you understand what they have to say, you will see the need of revising all your conclusions about yourself. And then all those very aspirations will not be there. And so the purpose of need for karma will not be there. In that sense we say that Vedanta sa prasvarte pramanyam, meaning that they are authority in their own self without having to be supported by something or without having to support something else. We don't require karmakanda to say, yes, Vedanta is pramanam. We don't require perception anything to say that Vedanta is pramanam. Nor do we have to verify by means of some other means of knowledge what Vedanta says. Vedanta is svatah pramanam, like every pramanam. Every means of knowledge is valid in itself. Again, where will you stop otherwise? My eyes tell me that the flower is red. But no, the flower cannot be red. Even though my eyes say that, the flower cannot be red. Suppose I question that. But why do you say, because when I touch the flower, I get the idea that this must be jasmine flower, and jasmine cannot be red. Therefore, even when I see the flower is red, then I can't believe that. But when you touch and conclude that it is jasmine, then how will you do that? Then you must smell it. So by the touch you came to the conclusion that it is jasmine. But then you'll question the knowledge generated by the sense of touch also. It says, no, wait a minute, let me smell it. But the smell says that it must be rose, and therefore the knowledge that I gained by touch also is not right. But now you have to question what the smell tells, you know. The point is that each one of these is a pramanam, the valid means of knowledge in its own sphere, and you do not have any other valid source to question. As far as smell is concerned, the nose alone is a pramanam and not a taste. The taste is concerned, tongue alone is pramanam and not touch. Touch is concerned, skin alone is pramanam, not the eyes. And therefore, you have to submit and thus understand that every moment we stand submitted. To what? To our pramanam. We think we never surrender ourselves. Every moment we stand surrendered to what we call pramanam, or the means of knowledge. So even as these words are heard, we all stand surrendered to listening to these words and trust that what the ears are telling me is what Swamiji is saying. No, from the moment of the lips of Swamiji, I feel that what he says is different from what my ears are telling me. That means what? My eyes are pramanam for words or what? This process will never end. So understand that there is a lot of trust involved in our life every moment. We are trusting our pramanam. There is a continue that trust, you know. So continue. Don't become an untrusting person. Anyway, Vedantaha, of course, they have their own criterion of what is meant by manam, what is pramanam. They have their own criterion. Vedantaha swarthena manam siddhartha vakyatvat. Because Vedantas only talk about siddhartha, artha or an entity that is siddha, that is already existing. So Vedantas talk about an entity such as Brahma or Atma that is already existing. And you don't require Vedantas to make you know what is already there, because you can know it yourself. So you don't require Vedantas to tell you. And suppose you are told that this is day and this is night and this is wind and so what? It doesn't serve any purpose to know merely the nature of the thing that is obtaining. So arodi dityadivat is anumanat. Thus going to karmakanda, there is a whole class of statements called arthavada. So arthavada is vakya of stuti or vakya of ninda, which serves the purpose of vidhi. And so arthavada, one of the arthavada is bhuta arthavada, meaning a statement that just describes what happened. Sah arodi. So that's what Bhashyakara is going to say here. So arodi, he wept. That fire wept. So in a particular yaga, they gave the dakshina, they gave silver in dakshina instead of gold. So idea is that gold must have been given in dakshina, instead of that, silver was given in dakshina. That means a fault was committed. And seeing this act, the fire which was watching all these acts wept. Saha arodi. So this is called bhutarthavada. This is a description of what happened. But why are they telling us this story that the fire wept? And since he wept, therefore he was called Rudra. So Rudi Roditi is Rudra. One who weeps is called Rudra. Saha arodi. Since he wept, therefore is called Rudra. Rud means to weep. Rudanam. So what they are conveying from that is, since that fire wept, he wept because something wrong was being done. He wept when he witnessed that silver was being given in dakshina. And that means that what was done there was wrong, otherwise fire would not have wept. That means that silver should not be given in dakshina. That means what? Gold should be given in dakshina. So sa arodi, that he wept, is understood as serving the purpose of statement. What? Barhishi rajatam nadeyam. There is a vidhi statement that in this yaga you should not give silver as dakshina. You must give gold. What happens if you give silver? Then the fire weeps. And so this statement, saha arodi, which describes what happened, that the fire wept, is in fact meant us to understand, is meant to make us understand that you should not give silver in dakshina. So main vakya is what? Barheshi rajatam nadeyam. In a given yaga, silver should not be given as dakshina. In this statement, saha arodi, the fire wept, is a statement that serves the purpose of that vidhi indirectly by, say, fire wept, means something wrong was done, and silver was given in dakshina, so that means that is wrong, and the silver should not be given in dakshina. And thus, that vakya, saha arodi, he wept, is arthavada, serving the purpose of that vidhi, barhishi rajatam nadeyam. And so, that saha arodi is not to be understood for what it says, is to be understood as serving the purpose of that vidhi. So it doesn't have swarthi pramanyam, it has pararthi pramanyam. Okay. So tesham vidisheshatvam saha arodi is a vidisheshavakya vakya, meaning it serves the purpose of vidhi. Similarly also, why is it vidhi? Because it only describes what happened. Saha arodi is a vakya that describes what happened. So this is what happens. Whenever there is a vakya that describes what happened or just the way things are, it is always classified as a vidishesha vakya, serving the purpose of vidhi. Vedantas, meaning the Upanishads, also describe what is Brahma and what is Atma, meaning describing the nature of reality. Therefore also they fall in the class similar to that statement, saha arodi, he wept. And therefore, just as that is vidisheshatvam, these vakyas also are vidisheshatvam. So Vedantas do not have pramanyam in swartha, they have pramanyam in with reference to being karmakanda, vidishesha with reference to karmakanda. So this is the standard thing. In Brihadaranyaka it is taken up for the first time. So otherwise, this is a standard thing. Vastu Swarupayati. So Vashyakara says, Vastu Swarupa Anvakhyana Matratva Apramanyam Iti Chet. Vastu Swarupa Anvakhyana Matratva. In as much as Upanishads merely Matratva, merely state the nature of things. Vastu Swarupa, the nature of Vastu, the nature of reality, nature of things. Anvakhyanam kathanam. Matratvad, in as much as Upanishads merely state the nature of reality. See footnote number 5. Vastu idi chidekarasatma swarupa anuvada matratvad ityardha. So Vedanta se atma is what? Chidananda rupa, or Satchidananda, or Satyam Jnanam Anandam Brahma. So Vedanta has merely restated, what is say, what is the fact? That Atma is Satyam Jnanam Anandam Brahma is. And that's what Vedanta says. Let's go Anuvada. Anuvada is what? Reiterating what is there. Pravartaka Nivartaka Dhi Janakatva Bhava Matra Shabdartha. And so the Vedanta Vakyas do not create inducement of an activity, nor do they create inducement of or desisting from an activity. That's what they want. Which is the Vakya that serves the purpose of our life, where it induces me to perform some activity, or it tells me what not to do. Suppose I'm about to do something wrong, then say, don't do that. So that also is useful to me. And when I don't know what to do, he says, do that. That also is a useful statement to me. So according to them, only a Vakya that creates Pravartaka Dhi. So, Pravartaka Nivartaka Dhi. Either to induce to do something or induce not to do something. There is a natural desire, natural impulse is there to do something. It says, don't do it. That's called Nisheda. There is no impulse to do anything. It says, do it. So, create an impulse or quell an impulse. See, human being an impulsive person. And so, either you create an impulse, then you will do something. Or you can dismiss that impulse, then you will stay away from doing something. So this is what the Vedas do. And only those Vakyas which create Pravartakadhi or Nivartakadhi induce us to do something or create inducement to stay away from something, then alone they are meaningful Vakyas, therefore Pramanam. No such thing is done by the Upanishad Vakyas. You are Brahman, so what should I do about it? Nothing. As we said, whatever is to be done, that itself comes to an end. So the Mimamsaka says that since the Vedanta Vakyas do not create Pravartaka Nivartaka Dhi, therefore they do not have Pramanyam iti chet. So Vedantanam apramanyam, Vedantas are not Pramanam iti chet. And that is explained here. So Anumanam is involved here. What is Anumanam? Vedantaha Swarthenamanam. That Vedantas do not have Pramanyam in Swartha in themselves. Why this so hetu? Siddhartha Vakyatvat. Because they only delineate something that is already an existing entity. What is Drishtanta? Sah Arodhi. Like a statement, he wept. So it just makes a statement of what is there, so it doesn't have Pramanyam in itself. Similarly also Vedantas only say about Atma and Brahman which are there, therefore they do not have Pramanyam. Iti Anumana. So this Anumanam is to be remembered. Because subsequently this Anumanam will be found to be defective. Iti Tesham Vidisheshatvam Pramanyartham Estavyam. What happens is, Mimamsakas are also committed to one principle. That every word of the Veda is Pramanam. Every word. Sometimes the words are Pramanam directly or sometimes indirectly. So the Mimamsakas will say that these Vidhi Vakyas and Nisheda Vakyas are Pramanam and rest of the Vakyas are Avantara Vakyas, secondary Vakyas, and by serving the purpose of Vidhi Vakyas they become Pramanam. So either all the Vakyas of the Vedas have Pramanyam because of their own self or they have Pramanyam because they serve the purpose of some Vidhi Vakya. And so if you don't accept Upanishad as Vidhi Shesha, If you don't accept Upanishad as serving the purpose of karma, then they will lose their pramanyam, and that is not desirable. So you are also, it says Vedantin, he tells the Vedantin, that you want that the Vedanta pramanam, isn't it? Yes. But Vedantas cannot be pramanam in themselves, swasya pramanam cannot, because they only talk about Atma and Brahman, existing entities. Yes. Therefore you would accept that they are only Arthavada, that by serving the purpose of the Vidhi, that they get pramanam. So they console us that you will lose, you know, that Veda pramanam will be lost if you don't accept Vidhisheshatvam. So pramanyartham eshtabhimiti shankate vastu swarupa tadeva anuvanam prapanchayati, that very anuvanam prapanchayati is elaborated here, tathapiti, athapiti. Athapi, athapi syat, yatha. Pramanyam evam atmathavakyanam api idi che. Explaining that very statement, asabhisya, to illustrate, yatha sorodit yat arodit tad rudrasrudratvam iti vamado, that he wept. Which is footnote number, no, there is no footnote. Saha arodit, since, yat arodit, since he wept, tad rudrasya rudratvam. That's why he is called Rudra. So agni or fire is called Rudra because he wept. He wept. Since he wept, therefore, he came to be called Rodanat Rudra. Therefore, he is called Rudra. It is eva madhav, in this kind of statement, vastu sarup anvakhyana matratvat. What is done there is what? Merely a statement, or merely what we call the reiteration of the nature of things, or what happened. Apramanyam, that's the reason why those vakyas, the vakyas falling in this particular class, all of them are looked upon as apramana, as not valid or not authoritative. But they're authoritative merely in terms of serving the purpose of vidhi. Evam atmasa vakyana vichet. Similarly also, vakyas which only reveal the nature of Atma, they also have to be looked upon as vakyas of this class, Arthavada, because they also only reveal the nature of an entity that is existing. So Athabi means what? Videhe ashrutatvevi iti avada. Even though we do not see directly vidhi, saha arodhi, he wept. It's not a vidhi vakya, it doesn't tell you to do anything. Still it is called pramanam because it serves the purpose of vidhi. So even if you do not see vidhi openly, still you can read the vidhi. That's what we do, our, you know. So when somebody describes you all kinds of wonders, you know, hey, have you seen Chidambaram? Have you seen Guru Vayu? Have you seen all these temples? When you describe, why is Swami saying all these things? Because they are planning the trip in November. And therefore, in order to, now then people are induced. Oh, Chidambaram is so beautiful, then I want to see it. All right, then we are going in November, join us, oh, whatever it is. So suppose, so sometimes when only this kind of descriptions are given, we know the purpose is something else. Purpose is to induce us to do something. And in that sense, those vakyas serve the purpose. Similarly also, the saharodhi, it serves the purpose by inducing you to do something indirectly. In that far, even though you do not directly see a vidhi that you must come, still there is an inducement. So you are not directly told that everybody should join or what it is. And still, by just giving certain descriptions, you know, that an inducement is created in the person. And that's how sometimes inducement is created directly, or sometimes inducement is created indirectly. Because it requires more sophistication of understanding to see that inducement is meant here. Sometimes those things are all lost, you know. And so, inducement doesn't get created. You wait for years together, inducement is not created sometimes anyway. But anyway, sometimes you directly instruct, sometimes you hope that inducement is created by merely by. So sometimes you want that the inducement should come from there, rather than your inducing. So there are a whole class of people who believe that inducement should come from the person. Then alone it is right to do things. There are others who believe that we have to induce them. That will never happen, Swami. You tell them, you know. Therefore, sometimes there is hammering in instruction. Sometimes there is suggestion, you know. So therefore, certain vakyas of Veda are suggesting vakyas. Some vakyas are instructing vakyas. So this Saharodhi, merely by describing an event, are only suggesting something. Similarly, that's how this they become pramana. And similarly also, so videhe ashrutatva, even though you do not directly see an inducement there, still this serves the purpose of videhe. Then Bhashyakara has to point out what is the difference between the Karmakanda Vakyas and Vedanta Vakyas. Yes, both are the Vakyas that merely reiterate the nature of things. And still, what is the nature of things in spite of that being common? See, Anumanam is where the Hetu is there. What is the Hetu? Siddhartha Vakyavat, that's the Hetu. Saharodhi, he wept also is a description of an event. And Ekameva Advitiyam, Brahman is one without a second also is a description of an existing entity. In that sense, both Vakyas fall in a similar class. But we say that that is not the only thing about the Vakyas. There is something that is distinct between them, which actually separate, distinguish those Vakyas also. It is like saying that because you are an Indian, therefore you must be like that. It's, wait a minute, all Indians are not like that. So, sometimes, so when you go abroad, then Indians means this. So, wait a minute, you have to come to know all of them, you know. And so, because Indians have created certain impressions, you know. Good and bad, both. Not Indians have created good impressions also, everywhere in the world. But, you know, certain things are Indians, population and every, you know, they are known for something. Some traits are there. So certain traits become evident, you know, when you live there for a certain time, and therefore, people automatically brand you, Indian means such and such. Wait a minute, all Indians are not alike. Indians coming from such and such place, Indians having such and such background are different from Indians coming from a different place and different background. And therefore, in spite of the fact that the Indianness is common, there can be uncommon things which can separate them, and though they should be treated separately. And similarly, for example, Mauritius, you know, so Swamiji, from now on, all Indians will have to get passport, visa. Otherwise, Mauritius doesn't require visa, you know. Depends on the kind of agreement the countries have. So what happened? Well, because all kinds of, smuggling is going. Smuggling what? Drugs. So, there is so much of drug smuggling from India to Mauritius that so many Mauritians have become drug addicts, you know, because of this. So because some trade in Pakistan has to go on, so the drugs are, brought into India, smuggled to India. And from India they are smuggled to Mauritius. And in Mauritius they are smuggled through the customs. And they are smuggled to the people. And that's how the whole drug addiction is created there. From such a big channel is there. So since many Indians were caught, or several Indians were caught carrying drugs, therefore, every Indian will have to. I said, wait a minute, you can't brand every Indian the same. But this is how it happens. What happens is, they are all treated equal. In Oman, for example, the Sultanate Sultan is there. The Sultan is excellent, Swamiji. Here all discipline, you know, like India. So Indians also feel that that's a much better place than India. It's not like India, you know, that you can do whatever you want. The law and order, you must follow the law. So that's good. And that's what people do. So it seems that at some point in time, there were paan shops, you know, paan. And so there were some fellows who were spitting as they do. Moment was found out that the people are spitting paan, all paan shops are closed, no more paan. See, Swamiji, everything stopped right away by one decree. And that's fine. But you cannot insist that everybody who eats paan necessarily spits. And just because some people are spitting, that you are depriving other people also who would have been eating paan and not spitting. So when these decrees come, you treat all of them in the same class. I said, that doesn't work in democracy. They cannot decree when people are just treated like that. People have freedom. Of course, freedom calls for responsibility. They have freedom to eat paan, but they extend their freedom to spit also, which is wrong. But that is to be corrected not by police,
is to be corrected by education. This is how democracy works. A very slow process, very painful process. And we are all undergoing those pains right now. So a lot of things that are happening in India, and you know, it just is exasperating. And our conclusion that Indians don't deserve democracy, that may be right, wrong or indifferent. But the thing is, democracy is always like that. One has to grow. Democracy demands that we should grow. We are not willing to grow, and therefore democracy is so difficult. Growth requires learning, understanding and a responsibility. We always are accustomed to giving responsibility to someone else, that the British will do, Raja will do. So the king used to take all the responsibility of the decrees, and for centuries together we are so accustomed to being instructed. Starts from Vedas, you know, instruct. Because all scriptures are like that. So we are accustomed to being instructed, and then alone we can do things. But there is Upanishad also, which is not of the nature of instruction, which is of the nature of an inspiration from within, and that comes by education. And so what we seek to do is to provide adequate education so that people are induced to act in a responsible manner. Ideally, you don't require police. In democratic country, ideal situation, as Tolstoy wrote, you know, there should be no courts and no police and no army. Not that it is ever going to happen and things like that. This is all idealistic situation. Mahatma Gandhi was highly inspired by Tolstoy, but he realized that this is all impractical, you know. He didn't go to that extent. That fellow went to that extent. Do away with all the courts. Because Christianity teaches love. In love, there cannot be any kind of force. There cannot be any restraint. There should be no armies, no courts, no police, nothing. Do away with everything. Except that, when can you do that? When you have people who are mature and responsible. Otherwise, then the fellows who do away things, right, will be exploited, you know, by all kinds of evil elements, etc. So, it's okay. All I'm saying is, ideally, when people are responsible, you don't require anything. So, democracy requires responsibility. Responsibility requires education, maturity. And when will that happen? Nobody ever knows. It doesn't look like it will ever happen at the moment, you know. But then, we have to act on trust and keep on doing. Look, see, it requires a tremendous boldness on the part of our leaders still to promote the idea of democracy. It's not an ordinary thing. It's very easy to fall for the idea of some Rajya, etc., you know, and then some decrees, etc. Sounds very good, all right. But whenever there is a decree, there is suppression. Whenever there is a decree, there cannot be there cannot be everybody who ever fall in every instruction. So Vedas also don't give decrees. Adhikaritam is always there. The moment you, without any exception, ask people to do something, that means they're going to be suppression. So there is always decrees, always involves suppression. Democracy is freedom. There should be no suppression. Of course, freedom can always be abused, and so there is a lot of abuse of freedom going on because of lack of maturity and lack of responsibility and so forth. That is where we should attack, rather than taking away the freedom. So choice is, where should we take away freedom from people because they will not grow, or we should do something that then they grow and leave the freedom. So far we are acting on the principle that we should give them the freedom and do what is required to enable them to own up that freedom, which is a very, very slow process and very painful process. This is what we have. Hindu Rajya, etc. is all nice. This, everybody should be driven away and stuff like that. Not that anything is practical, but lot of suppression and lot of repression is there. And so, secularism, whatever it means is, right, an equal freedom to everybody. Secular doesn't mean it is opposed to religion or anything. That all the religions have equal freedom, that's all. Every human being has equal freedom. Religion is secondary. Every human being has equal freedom. These are all tall talks, meaning, these are tall talks means what? Very high ideas, which are very, very difficult to meet by human beings. And it is true, but human beings have to grow, that's why the human beings are there. Otherwise, you would have been donkeys and monkeys and buffaloes, and then no democracy is required. God alone controls them, and therefore, they don't have freedom to be other than what they are. Human being has been given that freedom by God, so that freedom should be explored. This is the idea, anyway. So where did we go to all of these things anyway? Videya Srutatvevi, I should not become like other Mahatmas, you know, who just go on and on and on, and then forget, where did I start, you know? So anyway, that's why somebody said, because there was a conference of the Mahatmas, from the seminar, so all the Mahatmas were given the Vishaya topics, you know. Nobody ever stayed on any topics. So this Mahatma is the one who organizes, yes, yes. Praya Mahatma Avishayi hoya karte hain. Mahatmas are what? Nirvishaya. They talk of always Brahman which is Nirvishaya. They don't see the need for staying with Vishaya at all. Just go all over, wherever they want. Thank God Bhashyakara will not allow us to do it anyway. But this is where the vidhi and the reinstatement of the facts of life. We are talking about this actually. That where the vidhi is required and where merely the knowledge or understanding is required. We are talking of two different persons, persons of two different levels of maturity. Karmakanda addresses the person who needs to grow, and Upanishad addresses the person who doesn't have that need to have that kind of maturity. Thereby, sadhana, chatusya, sampatti, etc. The idea is that he just needs to know that the required maturity has taken place. And therefore, there is a distinction between the vakyas of Karmakanda and Upanishad. Even though both the vakyas only reiterate the facts or reiterate merely what is the nature of things, and still, inasmuch as the Upanishads address to people who have that level of maturity, for whom understanding is an end and not a means. So Karmakanda addresses people for whom understanding is a means to accomplish something. Upanishad addresses people for whom the understanding is a means in an end in itself and not a means to something else. Therefore, we say that there is some upadhi. Upadhi means what? Some asadharana karanam is there. Something asadharana, something unique is there in Upanishad as against Karmakanda, which makes Upanishad Vakyas unique and in a class different from Karmakanda. So uniqueness is called upadhi. Say Anandagiri, Halavat Nishchita Jnana Janakatvam Upadhi Iti Manvanaha. That Upanishad Vakyas have this characteristic that Halavat Nishchita Jnana Janakatvam, that they Jnana Janakatvam, they create the knowledge. What kind of knowledge? Nishchita Jnana Janakatvam, they create ascertained knowledge. And what? Halavat Nishchita Jnana Janakatvam. So they generate knowledge which is free from any doubts, etc. At the same time, Halavat. Halavat means what? Which is fruitful, which itself is end. In short, Upanishads create the knowledge, which knowledge itself is Halavat. Knowledge itself serves is end in itself, and which is Nishchitam Jnanam. So, inasmuch as Upanishad Vakyas give us a knowledge which itself serves the purpose, in that sense, so here knowledge itself serves the purpose. In Karmakanda, the knowledge does not serve the purpose. Knowledge serves the purpose by inducing us to do something, and the doing serves the purpose. Here, knowledge itself serves the purpose. And that kind of knowledge, definite knowledge, is given by Upanishad. Therefore, Upanishad Vakyas are not, cannot be compared in every way with the Karmakanda Vakyas. In some way they can be compared, inasmuch as both of them reiterate the nature of things. But they are not comparable in every way. In some ways they are different from each other, and this is a difference. That's what Bhashyakara says. Hence it is given na. Na vishesha na vakyasya vastvan vakhyanam kriyan vakhyanam va pramanya apramanya karanam kim tarhi nischita phalavata vijnanotpadakatvam tat yatra asti tat pramanam vakyam yatra nasti tad apramanam. Bhashya says no vishesha, that yes, from what you say, that both the Vakyas, Upanishad Vakyas and the Arthavada Vakyas, that both of them only reiterate the nature of things, and that way they are similar.
But visheshat, the Upanishad vakyas have certain distinction which the Karmakanda vakyas do not have. What's the distinction? So first of all, Vasyakara says, na vakyasya vastu anvakhyanam kriya anvakhyanam va pravanya pravanya karanam. So you cannot decide that a vakya is pramana vakya, meaning the authoritative vakya or the valid vakya, generating the true knowledge. You cannot say the vakya is pramana vakya, authoritative vakya, on the basis of whether it actually reiterates the nature of thing or whether it creates an inducement. That is not the criterion to determine whether the vakya is pramana or not. What is pramanam? Pramakaranam pramanam. See, where is the word? Pramakaranam pramanam. Prama means what? Halavat nischita jnanam is pramana. Prama is the valid knowledge which itself is end. So knowledge itself serves the purpose. And which is valid knowledge, so that is called prama. What is prama? Pramanam, pramakaranam, pramanam. So that means of knowledge that generates a knowledge that is valid, which cannot be negated, and which serves the purpose. So I see the flower, and this is flower, that's all. That is serve the purpose in that sense. Understand that every knowledge serves its own purpose. There's no problem. When I saw the flower, then I wanted to have it. That is not the result of this knowledge, result of something inside. The moment you see that flower, immediately you want to go to the garden and pluck that flower. So you say that the knowledge of flower has created the inducement of plucking it. No, it is not the knowledge that has created. Knowledge has created the knowledge that it is a jasmine flower. But then that knowledge reminds you that, hey, I want a jasmine, you know. So that reminds you of a desire. It is a desire that prompts you to pluck the flower. And not just the knowledge that is jasmine. If the knowledge creates an inducement, everybody should go and pluck that. Everybody doesn't do that, only some people do. Why? Because it is not the knowledge that induces. It is that all was discussed in Brahma Sutra. Knowledge doesn't induce. Knowledge just tells you what it is. Something inside induces. Some impulse inside induces. Which may be perhaps invoked, you know, by the situation. And it is that which induces you. And then if knowledge itself induces, everybody should perform those yagas. You know, everybody doesn't do that. Svarga kamo yajeta. One is desire of svarga alone will perform the yaga, not everybody. And so, what is pramana? So Bhashyakara explains it very well. Nishchita phalavat vijnana utpadakat utpadakatvam pramanyam. Pramana. Pramakaranam pramanam. Nishchita phalavat vijnana utpadakatvam. And so, nischita means that which is not negatable, you know, that which is not negated, abhaditam. And phalavat, phalavat means that which serves its own purpose. Phalavat, that is meaningful. So when meaningful and purposeful and valid knowledge is created, so that is what pramanam does. And not inducing into activity, or not inducing the activity, telling the nature of things, or not telling the nature of things is not the criterion. But pramanam is that which generates prama. And what is prama? Nischita phalavat vijnanam pramanam. Tad yatrasti tad pramanam. Tad pramanam vakyam. Yatra nasti tad pramanam. So, what is the criterion of determining whether a vakya is pramana vakya or not? When that vakya is to create, nischita phalavat vijnanam, it creates vijnanam. Suppose you come to know it's so or it's so what, doesn't create any result, therefore it is not pramanam. Not because it describes the nature of thing that it is not pramanam, but because it doesn't serve my purpose, therefore it is not pramanam. So knowledge that serves the purpose, and that is a certain knowledge, is called pramanam. So that way it is pramanam that it gives you knowledge, that purpose it does, but it is not pramanam from your criterion, that it must always serve the purpose of inducement. So you don't call it pramanam. No, I don't know. That would be yet another kind of a thing. But here you are accepting their criteria, we are saying, you see. Tad yatrasti. So, visheshaṁ vyachaste kim tarhi nischita phalavat vijñānotpādakatvam tasya pramānya prayojakatvam anvayavidrikābhyam darshayati. So, Bhāshyakara shows how tasya pramānya prayojakatvam nischita phalavat vijnanasya pramanya prayojakatvam, that how it is this kind of vijnanam, this kind of knowledge that actually decides whether a vakya is pramanam or not. Says tad yatra asti tad pramanam. Wherever a sentence creates this kind of knowledge, that is called pramanam. Yatra nasti tad pramanam. where the statement fails to create this knowledge is not pramanam. And therefore we say that, so Bhashyakara gives a proper definition of pramanam, which they all know, but they forget. What happens? They also know this. In fact, we learn this from them. But at some point in time, they forget this. Such a preoccupation with karma, that sometimes fundamentals are forgotten. And you get so devoted to karma, karma and inducement, that you forget your own definition of how you define pramanam. So Bhashyakara says, look, pramanam is that which generates prama. Let us be talk at fundamental levels. Pramanam is that which generates prama, that's all. It has nothing to do with whether that knowledge induces or not. Whether that is knowledge of an existing entity, or knowledge of an unknown entity, or knowledge that induces, this is not the criterion. It is knowledge, it generates knowledge, which is abhajitam jnanam, which cannot be negated. And that knowledge itself serves the purpose for which you wanted to know, then it is pramanam. So wherever that criterion is, that vakya is pramanam. Where that criterion is not, the vakya is not pramanam. Okay, we'll continue. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti 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 Shankaram Shankaracharyam Keshavam Badarayanam Sutra-bhashya krutau vande bhagavantau punah punah Ishvaro gurur-atmedi smurti-veda-vibhagine Vyoma-vatyapta-dehaya dakshinamurtaye namah Om shanti 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 Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namah Hari Om
Idam Tarhya Vyakrita Masir Tannama Rupa Abhyam Eva Vyakriyata Asau Namayam Idam Rupaiti Tadidamapyetarhi nama rupa abhyam eva vyakriyate Asau namayam idam rupaite Sa eshaiha pravishtanathagrebhyah Yatakshurah kshuradhane vahidasya Vishvambharo va Vishvambhara kulaye Tanna pasyandi Akrishno hi saha Prananeva prano nama bhavati Vadanva Pasyam chakshuhu Shrunvan shrotram Manvano manaha Tanyasya itani karma namanyeva Sayata ekaikam upaste nasaveda Akrasno hyeshaha Ata ekaikena bhavate Atmetyevo pasita Atrashyeda sarvam ekam sarva ekam bhavatne Tadhedat padaniyamasya yasya Tadamedat padaniyamasya sarvasya dayamatma Anena shyedat sarvam veda Padenanu vinde devam Gitim slokam vindate evam veda Akshana matratvat apramanya vichet. Yet another point that we say that Upanishad vakyanam apramanyam
that the Vakyas, the Upanishad, are not Pramanam, meaning they do not reveal the nature of truth, or they are not the valid means for the knowledge, inasmuch as Vastu Swarupam Vakyanamatratvat, that they merely reiterate the nature of the things, the nature of the reality, nature of Brahma. Athabhisyad yatha sorodit yadho adhyadar yat arodit tadrudyasrudratvam ityavadav vastu swarupa anvakhyanamatrattvat apramanyeva. In short, these vakyas of Upanishad are compared with the arthavada vakyas, just as saha arodit, that he wept. And this is a statement of what happened. So this is just a reiteration of what happened. And so that statement, the Karmakanda, is not looked upon as Pramanavakya, it is looked upon as Arthavada. By Pramana means Swarthe Pramanyam. That which conveys its own meaning without depending upon anything else, or which conveys a meaning which is not dependent, which does not serve the purpose of anything else, where Vidhisheshatvam is not there, Vidhi Upakaragatvam is not there, that the Vakya does not serve the purpose of Vidhi, but Vakya serves to reveal its own meaning. So this is called Pramanya. Swarthe Pramanyam, where Vakya reveals its own meaning. We say that these Upanishad Vakyas are comparable to these Arthavada Vakyas, like Saharodhi, which only describe the happening. And therefore, this statement, for example, Saharodhi, becomes a Vidhishesha, serves the purpose of Vidhi, Barhishi Rajatam Nadeyam, that in the Vayaga, Rajata or silver should not be given. Similarly also, we say that all these statements of the Upanishad also serve the purpose of some karma, like Upasana. Atma Vare Drashtavya, Atma Itya Upasita. So to enable us to perform the Upasana or meditation upon the Atma, all these Vakyas of the Upanishad are. So in short, the point, technical point is that a statement which just reveals the nature of things, how can it be considered as pramanam? What purpose does it serve in our life? According to the Mimamsakas, that is called pramanam, which serves a purpose in our life. That's the purpose of the Vedas, for the scriptures. So what purpose is served by knowing, you know, what happened? Or by knowing the way things are, what purpose is served? So no purpose is served. And so, in short, these Vakyas of Upanishads are comparable to the Arthavada Vakyas of the Karmakanda. The answer was given, Vishesha, this is all. There is a Vishesha. Whatever, Phalavat Nishchita Jnana Ajanagatvam. Okay? Inasmuch as the Arthavada Vakyas, they do not generate a knowledge, which is Phalavat and Nishchitam Jnanam. So that the Vakya that generates the knowledge, which is Nishchitam, which is the determined or ascertained knowledge, Phalavat, which knowledge itself is purposeful, then we say that Vakya is a Pramana Vakya. So here Vashyakara explains what is the criterion for determining the Pramanyam of a statement, whether the statement is Pramana, meaning a means of knowledge or not. So said Vashyakara, na vakyasya vastvan vakhyanam kriyan vakhyanam va pramanya pramanyakaranam. You cannot say that just because a vakya or a statement reveals the nature of things, or because it reveals the nature of action, that it assumes the state of the pramanyam or a pramanyam. Kim tarhi, then what's the criterion of determining whether a vakya is pramana or not? Nishchita phalavat vijnana upadgatvam. That when a vakya generates a knowledge, it is nishchitam and phalavat. Nishchitam jnanam meaning that which cannot be threatened or assailed by any other knowledge. So that cannot be assailed by the knowledge generated by another pramana. Thus, when I smell a flower, then the smell, that's a knowledge. Now that smell, that knowledge cannot be assailed by. Just because I see, I believe that the flower is rose, it cannot smell like that. But my nose says the flower smells like jasmine. So my eyes are not pramanam to determine the nature of smell.
Eyes can be pramanam to are pramanam to determine the nature of color. And so looking at the color, I might say this is jasmine, it may be something else. The point is, as far as smell is concerned, the faculty of smelling is a pramana. So question was, Swamiji, suppose there is a rose in front of you. So you say that this is rose. In fact, it may not be a real rose. It may be a paper rose or a cloth rose. And a silk rose. And it is made so vividly, even if you touch, sometimes you can't tell right away whether it's real or not. So you might conclude, you see this object and conclude that it is rose, and that is wrong. It is not rose, it's a false rose. Now how can you say that what the eye see is always pramana? Or sometimes if you sprinkle even fragrance on that rose, and so even if you smell that rose, you might feel that it is real rose and it may not be real. So how can you say that your nose has necessarily revealed the nature of rose, or the eyes have necessarily revealed the nature of rose? Our answer is that eyes do not say that it is rose. Eyes only say that this is red color. That is unquestionable. The nose also does not reveal that it is rose. Nose merely says that this is a smell, and that is again unquestionable. That it is rose is a conclusion of the buddhi. Eyes merely give the knowledge of color. Nose merely gives the knowledge of smell, and they are valid. You cannot say that the smell is not that of rose. Whether object is rose or not is a problem elsewhere. But that this is a smell of a rose is what the nose reveals, and that's true. That the color of the rose is what the eyes reveal, that's also true. This is the touch of the rose, which is all the sense of touch reveals, that touch also is right. Whether it is rose or not is a different thing. So what happens is our mind actually synthesizes the knowledge obtained from different sense perceptions, and then from its own memory comes to the conclusion that this is rose. Now there mistake can be made. But what the sense of perception has revealed is right anyway. And maybe you have to investigate more, maybe you have to taste that thing ultimately. You have to tear it apart, you have to do something in order to determine whether it's real or not. But understand that whatever the pramanam or the valid means of knowledge reveals is valid. Then alone it can be called pramanam. Where no other means of knowledge has a scope. Nose is the only competent means of knowledge we have for determining the nature of smell, and nothing else. You can't touch an object and determine the smell, or you can't taste it, or you cannot hear it, or do anything. Notice, only this is the faculty. But Swamiji, suppose in the dark, another question. This is sight questions anyway. In the pitch darkness, you are not able to see a pot, but you can know the pot not only by the eyes, you can know it also by the sense of touch. So not only eyes are pramanam to reveal that this is pot, but touch also is a pramanam to reveal this is pot. But here buddhi is a pramanam to reveal that this is pot, really. The sense of touch merely reveals the touch. Eyes merely reveal the color. And from that the buddhi determines that this is a pot. It is not the sense of touch that determines that this is pot or what. It only reveals the nature of touch. And therefore, again, eyes and touch, there is no overlapping. Eyes also function in their own realm. The sense of touch functions in its own realm. And this is what we mean by knowledge. Simple perception. Similarly also, the Vedavakyas enables to perceive the nature of things. In case of Karmakanda, the Vakyas enable us to perceive the nature of Dharma. In case of Upanishads, they enable us to perceive the nature of Self. And so what we are saying is, what is pramanam? Pramakaranam pramanam. Pramanam meaning the valid means of knowledge always reveals something, that's all it does. It's not that it prompts you to perform an activity or not, is the second stage. But first, all that the pramanam does is reveals the nature of things.
nischitam phalavat vijnanam. Phalavat meaning that vijnanam itself is the result. No, but what do you gain by knowing that this is part? That this is part, that itself is a gain. What else do you want? No, but I am no wealthier than what I am. Well, then it's a different thing. But this eyes have served the purpose by revealing the nature of color. Nischita phalavat vijnanotpadakatvam is the pramana karanam. So what determines the criterion that determines whether a vakya is valid means of knowledge or not? Only when it reveals the true nature of things, which knowledge cannot be assailed by any other knowledge, cannot be assailed, cannot be improved upon, cannot be negated by any other knowledge, is called pramana. If you then read something else, karmakanda, and learn that no atma is something else, or you see something and decide that no atma is something else, then this is not pramana. Meaning that all other means of knowledge at our disposal, namely the organs of perception and the mind, they cannot assail or threaten or question what the Upanishads say with reference to Atma, inasmuch as they do not have scope with reference to Atma, they cannot objectify the self, only the Upanishad Vakyas reveal the nature of the self. Tad yatrasti tad pramanam vakyam, yatra nasti tad apramanam. Wherever this criteria is satisfied, Nifalavat nischita vijnanotpadakatvam, wherever this criteria is satisfied, that vakya is pramanam. Where it is not pramanam. Now going to page 230, samanyanyayam prakrute yojan rojayan pachyati. This is samanyanyayam. What is samanyanyayam? Nischita phalavat vijnanotpadakatvam pramanatvam. So that is called pramanam, which generates nischita phalavat vijnanam. That is samanyanyayam. Prakrute yojayan. Now Vaishyakara applies that nyaya or general rule to prakruta, meaning to the statements of the Upanishads, and prachati, and ask the question of the Purupakshini. Says Vaishya, kincha bhoho prachyamastvam atmasurupan vakhyana pareshu vakyeshu phalavata nishchitam cha vijnanam utpadyate nava. Kinch bhoho uchyamastvam. So further we are asking you this. So this is a little more intimate conversation, no? Earlier also it came. Bhoho kim kritasya karanam. So kim kritasya karanena. Yes, bhoho uchyamastvam. Then we have to ask you this. Atmasurupa anvakhyana pareshu vakyeshu phalavat nishchitam. Phalavat nishchitam ca vijnanam utpadyate nava. Please tell us this. That the statement suggests tattvamasi aham brahmasmi atmasvarup anvakhyana pareshu vakyeshu. These vakyas are statements of Upanishads which are devoted to or which have the tatpariya, the purport in revealing the nature of Atma. Just the nature of Atma. So from these vakyas, phalvat nischitam ca vijnanam utpadyate nava. Please tell us whether or not this, from listening to the statements, or are these statements able to reveal the nature of the Atma and thereby give us the knowledge which is phalavat, which is the knowledge, valid knowledge, and nischitam, so that which is unassailable knowledge or unnegatable knowledge, are these vakyas able to give us that knowledge or not? Tell us this. Kim teshu tadrak jnana utpadyate nava iti prashnartha. So, in this vakyas, that kind of a knowledge, is it generated or not? Dvitiya anubhava virodhasya. If you say no, that means anubhava virodha. Because vidvat anubhava virodha, says footnote number 4, vidvat anubhava virodha, phalashvid virodhasya. The wise people's experience it is that, yes, Atma is known. It is the experience of the wise. And phalashvid virodhasya. Upanishad also says, what is the result of the knowledge of the Atma? So, Phalashruti. In every Upanishad, essentially, we have the Phalashruti. So,
So we hear the phalam, the result that one gains as a result of knowledge of the Atma. So when Upanishad says the wise man has this, this and this kind of, you know, different ways the Upanishad describes the phala, what kind of happiness he gains, and you know, the Chandogya Upanishad is his own way, Keno Upanishad is his own way, Mundaka Upanishad is his own way, Vidyate Vaya Grandhi Chidyande Sarvasamshayaha Tardishokam Atmavit Brahmavit Apnodi Param. So nor of Brahma attains the limitless, nor of the Atma crosses the ocean of grief. So all of these are Phalashruti. All of these tell us, Tashtitavadeva Chiram Yavanna Vimokshe. So long he has to wait until the body drops. So all of these statements tell us that the one who knows the self becomes free from grief and delusion. Tatra ko hims vashaka himself will say anyway. Tatra ko moha kashokaha. Where is the grief and where is the delusion when one comes to know the nature of the self? So Upanishad very clearly tells us what is the result of this knowledge. The Upanishad would have to be wrong because it gives us the Phalashruti, and the Vidwan, the wise people also have to be wrong because they also concur. They also concur what the Upanishad says. So Anandagiri says, Dvitiye Anubhava Virodha. If you decline that the Upanishad Vakyas do not generate that kind of knowledge, you're going to contradict the experience of the wise people as well as contradict the statement of the Upanishad which give us the result of this knowledge. Iti matva pakshantaram anudya pratyaha. So that the pakshantara is the first paksha. Utpadyade. Yes, that the knowledge is generated. Anudya, reiterating that pratyaha. Then the answer is given here. Utpadyade che. So says Vashya. Utpadyade che. Katama pramanyamiti.